Okay, so thank you for everyone for joining us tonight at our Knowledge in Motion lecture. Tonight we're webcasting in over 30 states nationwide and internationally to countries such as Canada, India, New Zealand, Portugal, and Mexico. So here we have Joanne Smith and Kylie James. They're nutritionists whose lives have been personally touched by spinal cord injury. They co-authored Eat Well, Live Well with Spinal Cord Injury, which is the first nutrition book dedicated to addressing the unique needs of people with spinal cord injury. So tonight, this lecture will discuss the important role nutrition plays in restoring balance to your body, enhancing your body's inherent healing potential, and to help protect you from developing secondary health conditions. Case studies will be used tonight to demonstrate the positive changes that proper nutrition can have on those certain conditions. So please help me welcome Kylie James and Joanne Smith.
Thank you so much, Caitlin, and good evening, everyone. I'm Joanne. Good evening. This is Kylie. And we want to say thank you so much for coming tonight, and a big thank you to Spalding Rehabilitation Center and Judy Zazula for inviting us to be here tonight. We are so excited to be here to have the opportunity to share this information with you regarding something that we are both very passionate about and isn't something that's discussed often in the SCI community, and that is, of course, nutrition. We're both nutritionists from Canada, from Toronto, and both of our practices specialize and focus on people with neurological conditions, both spinal and brain injuries. As Caitlin was saying, Kylie and I both have had personal experience and connection to spinal cord injury, which is what drew us to working in this particular field. I sustained a spinal cord injury over 25 years ago, and very, very quickly, I developed a host of secondary health complications, things like chronic bladder infections, neuropathic pain, tendinitis, just to mention a few. And it really interfered with my ability to function fully on a day-to-day basis. Kylie's nephew sustained a C3-4 quadriplegia when he was just 1.5 years old. He developed chronic respiratory infections very quickly, which is another common secondary health complication for people with spinal cord injuries. Now, we had both in our practices been independently trying to find spinal cord injury related specific information, nutritional research, and disappointingly, we found that despite the prevalence, the awareness, and the negative consequences associated with all of these secondary health complications that we face, there was limited information available focusing on nutrition and its impact on helping to manage, prevent, and address them. So we knew that if we were having trouble finding this information, so were others. So that's why 3 years ago we came together and we decided to research and write a resource specific to the needs of people with spinal cord injuries. Our hope is that this information will focus attention on the important therapeutic role nutrition plays in the lives of individuals with spinal cord injury and inspire future research in the area of nutrition and spinal cord injury. But most importantly, we hope the book that we have written will help empower you, your patients, or your clients to have greater control over your own health in an easy, practical, and cost-effective way.
So Joe and I received a grant from the Paralyzed Veterans of America to research and write a book specific to nutrition and SCI. We consulted with consumers and medical and healthcare practitioners while we were doing our research to get their feedback on what topics were most important to them and what was the most effective way to deliver this information. Repeatedly, we were told that people wanted consumer, user-friendly resource where they could get the nutritional information that they needed quickly. And this is what we've put together and what we will be presenting on tonight. As Joe was just mentioning, one of our goals with writing the book is to increase the awareness and importance of nutrition with individuals who have sustained an SCI and to encourage future research in this area. Joe and I spent months reading research articles, but the specific articles geared toward SCI, nutrition, and secondary health complications were too few and far between. That's why we're excited to be asked to be part of a research project at Brock University, which is to start in a few months. The study is looking at putting a group of individuals with SCI on an anti-inflammatory diet and supplement program and measuring how this impacts cytokine levels in the blood, so that's the inflammatory markers, and how this in turn impacts an individual's sleep, mood, and pain.
So for those of you in the room here tonight or joining us from home or other rehabilitation centers, and you've been through the rehab process, you work in the field, you know that nutrition has not traditionally played a significant role in the rehab process or long-term health care of people with SCI. And this is often reflected in the types of questions we're asked when we go to see our health care providers. One of the first questions that we're often asked is, what are you taking and what medications are you on? What is rarely asked is, what are you eating? The link between diet and disease is well established. We all know it's important to pay attention to what we eat, but it's especially important that people are conscientious of what they're eating after spinal cord injury, because it is very common for individuals with spinal cord injury to have poor diets post-injury and experience nutrient deficiencies. There are several contributing factors for this, such as change in economic status after injury, transportation mobility limitations to get out and buy healthy foods, difficulty in preparing healthy meals due to limited dexterity or chronic fatigue, and often people just reach for high-calorie, junk food, sugar-laden foods because it's comfort in a time of great stress. All of these can impact nutrient levels. And you can see here on the next slide, this is a list of some of the nutrients people with spinal cord injuries tend to be deficient in. I'll go through these all. Vitamin A, very important for skin integrity, strength, and your immune system. Vitamins B2, B9, and B12, very important for energy and nerve function. Vitamin D, of course, very important for bone health. We are at very high risk of developing osteoporosis. You need to make sure you're getting lots of vitamin D in your diet. Vitamin E is a very powerful antioxidant, very important for cardiovascular health. Cardiovascular disease is the number one killer of people with spinal cord injuries. Calcium, of course, very important for bone health. Chromium is a micro mineral which can help maintain good weight, proper weight, ideal weight. Over 65% of people with spinal cord injuries are overweight, so it's very important to manage your weight. Magnesium, very important for cardiovascular health as well. Zinc, very important for skin strength and immune system, which I'm going to talk about later for helping to prevent pressure sores. Fiber, of course, very important for proper bowel function and good bowel routines. And the last one here, essential fatty acids, so important for a number of health reasons. Together, all of the factors I just mentioned that contribute to poor diet and the nutrient deficiencies that I just talked about can contribute to the development of many common, recurring, and potentially life-threatening secondary health complications. And this is quite interesting. It's estimated that on average, a person with spinal cord injury has 7 secondary health complications a year. It's a lot, 7. And it can be a combination of any of the above, things like digestive dysfunction, constipation, bowel obstruction, bladder infections, obesity, pressure sores, osteoporosis, arthritis, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, pain, and or sleep disorders. These secondary health complications in turn place additional demands on your body for calories, protein, vitamins, and minerals. Therefore, eating the right foods becomes even more crucial for you in meeting your body's increased nutrient needs right after injury, through rehabilitation, and throughout your lifetime.
So nutrition has many benefits for people living with a spinal cord injury. Food has the amazing ability to help enhance the body's inherent healing potential. So when someone has a pressure sore, consuming certain nutrients can help enhance the healing process, and Joe will be talking about this shortly. It can help restore balance in the body, such as hormonal balances. It can help boost overall health and immunity, which can help to reduce the risk of bladder and respiratory infections. It can target the root cause of a health issue and not just the symptoms. As Joe was mentioning before, it can fulfill as often higher needs of nutrients that people with SCI have. It can also help replenish nutrients depleted by many of the medications that people with an SCI take. So for example, antibiotics. They are there to help get rid of the bad bacteria, but they also get rid of that good bacteria as well. And we need that good bacteria to help regulate the bowels, boost the immune system, and it actually helps to make some of those B vitamins. It also helps to prevent and manage the development of many secondary health complications. Equally as important, nutrition can help regain and maintain control. So when you've sustained a spinal cord injury, a certain portion of your bodies are no longer under your control, but what is important is to focus on that you still have control over other parts of your body and your overall health and well-being. So eating a well-balanced, nutrient-dense diet can ensure that all other systems in the body are working to their full potential. However, sometimes diet alone is just not enough. So taking medications is often a common component of a spinal cord injury's life, but supplements can also play an important role as well. Supplements are often overlooked, and there is a number of reasons why we look at supplements with people that have sustained a spinal cord injury. So following trauma or illness, we can often experience compromised digestive systems, which can lead to a decrease in nutrient absorption. So for example, reduced stomach acid. This can occur when taking certain medications, when under significant stress, and naturally decreases over the age of 40. Reduced stomach acid affects protein, mineral, and vitamin B12 breakdown and absorption into the body. So proteins are important because they help to make neurotransmitters, to help us feel happy, to help us feel motivated, to help us sleep, to help us feel calm. They also help to make antibodies, which help to boost our immune system. And it is needed to help preserve that precious lean muscle mass. B12 is important because that actually makes up part of the myelin sheath that surrounds the nerves and protects it. And also minerals such as calcium, magnesium are crucial for healthy bones. The body also has an increased demand for specific nutrients during times of stress and when addressing secondary health complications. So, example, vitamin D is essential for increasing calcium absorption into the body from 10 to 20% to 30 to 40%, and subsequently plays a role in preventing osteoporosis, which is another common secondary health complication. Studies show that vitamin D deficiency can range from 32 to 100% in individuals with an SCI. And sometimes it's hard to get enough. We get vitamin D from the sun, but this can be limited if geographical areas, temperature regulation, hospitalization, and covering up with sunscreen and clothing. It can also be difficult to get it from food sources as well. So supplementing with vitamin D is something that we commonly do in our practice. Spinal cord injury are at high risk of nutrient deficiencies, as Joe was just mentioning. And as a result, they can often require nutrient levels higher than their able-bodied counterparts. So for example, anemia is a common problem in SCI. B12 anemia can cause worsening pain, numbness, depression, reduced mobility, decreased strength, and memory loss. And one study suggested that a vitamin B12 deficiency for spinal cord injury should be 350 picograms per milliliter or lower, as opposed to the able-bodied population, which is recognized at 220 pg/mL. So food alone may not be able to provide the nutrient levels required for therapeutic effect. So for example, if someone needs to be put on a gut healing protocol, they need to be consuming significant amounts of L-glutamine. This is an amino acid that is used to help speed up the healing time of tissues. Now this would equate to drinking about a liter of cabbage juice a day, but realistically and practically, who's going to do that? So supplementing with L-glutamine in a powder format and taking it in an acid-based drink, such as tomato juice or apple juice, to increase the absorption can be a more practical way to get the therapeutic levels that they need. You also want to address the client's compliance and preference. So if someone does not eat fish or like fish, but needs to increase their intake of essential fats to help with regulating their bowels and reducing inflammation, then taking a fish oil may be required. supplementing can help bridge that gap if they can't get the specific nutrients from their diet. Certain medications deplete nutrients, and therefore supplementing to help compensate for this loss may be required. An example of this is statin drugs. Statin drugs help to lower cholesterol, but this can actually interfere with the production of COQ10, which is an important compound for heart health. So if you're taking a statin drug, you need to be supplementing with 30 milligrams of COQ10 a day. A lot of time, people, especially in the Western world, are buying foods that are cheap, convenient, and quick, which are often takeout, frozen dinners, and processed foods. And research shows that people with disabilities are even more likely to follow this regime. Nutrients have often been lost in the processing of these foods, and often added in their place are the trans fats, additives, colorings, and flavorings such as MSG. Many of these can have a negative effect on the nervous system. So to demonstrate the important role nutrition plays in helping address and manage and prevent secondary health complications, Joe and I are going to talk about two common secondary health complications and relate this to specific client cases. So that is pressure sores and bowel dysfunction. So approximately 80% of individuals with SCI experience one or more bowel complications. And unfortunately, neurogenic bowel tends to worsen over time. Regular bowel movements are important because they help to remove toxins, hormonal byproducts, and cholesterol from the body. If undigested food remains in the intestines for over 24 hours, then these substances get reabsorbed back into the bloodstream, and a person then becomes at greater risk of developing gas, hemorrhoids, diverticulitis, colon distension, and even a buildup of toxins in the colon known as intestinal toxemia. Peristalsis is the involuntary muscular contraction that moves that digested food particles through the intestines. After a spinal cord injury, peristalsis can be altered, and this can cause the bowel transit time to take twice as long. As a result of altered peristalsis and delayed transit time, a person with a spinal cord injury may experience abdominal bloating and pain, excessive gas, constipation, diarrhea, bowel accidents, incomplete emptying, and bowel obstruction. Some of these conditions can lead can lead complications such as diverticulitis, hemorrhoids, increased spasticity, intestinal perforation, autonomic dysreflexia, and colorectal cancer. In fact, the risk of colorectal cancer is 2 to 6 times more prevalent in the SCI population. So bowel issues can have a significant impact on a person's ability to engage in their daily activities. The time that it takes for people with an SCI to complete a bowel routine can take anywhere from 1 hour up to 5 hours a day and still have incomplete emptying. The overwhelming fear of having a bowel accident may prevent people from working, socializing, traveling, and participating in various activities outside the home. So the client case, that we're going to talk about, this is a young guy who prior to his injury was a sponsored athlete that was traveling around North America competing. He was 23 when he had his motor vehicle accident, and he sustained a T12 L1 incomplete paraplegia. So we saw him 3 years post-injury when he was 26, and his diet was terrible. It was full of refined carbs and low in fiber. He was living off pizza, white pasta, subs, cakes, processed cereals, and energy drinks. He was only having one bowel motion every 3 days, and this would be difficult to pass, and he found his bowel routine very time-consuming. It was ineffective, and a lot of the time it was incomplete. He had very low energy and fatigue. He was frequently napping in the afternoon, and basically he just felt drained all the time. He had abdominal pain with chronic, loud, foul-smelling gas and bloating. He was a very social guy prior to his injury, but his bowel issues had caused him a lot of social embarrassment and social isolation. He wouldn't date, he didn't leave his apartment, and he only went out for groceries and medical and therapy appointments. Basically, this guy was really depressed. So the first thing that we looked at doing is supporting digestive function. So digestive enzymes in our body help to break down carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. If we have insufficient digestive enzyme activity, we can experience problems such as gas, constipation, bloating, heartburn, discomfort after eating, and chronic fatigue. These were all problems that our client was experiencing. Poor digestive enzyme function can occur as a result of stress, which is often a problem for our clients as they're struggling with physiological stress, financial stress, emotional stress, etc. So when our digestive enzyme activity becomes insufficient, then our pancreas has to work that much harder to produce more digestive enzymes to meet the demands of the foods that we eat. We need to increase consumption of enzyme-rich foods. So these can be found in the raw fruits and vegetables, but when they are cooked, they will be destroyed. So juicing can actually help liberate enzymes from the fruits and vegetables, although juicing also takes away that precious fiber that our clients need as well. So smoothies made in a blender with fresh fruits and vegetables are a better option. This is because the enzymes are liberated from the food, but the fiber is still available to be consumed. Foods rich in enzymes include fresh green leafy vegetables such as your spinach, arugula, Brussels sprouts and cabbage, and fruits such as pineapple, papaya, and avocado. We also put this client on a digestive enzyme supplement, and we looked at like 1 to 2 pills a day, for each meal. And this not only contained the digestive enzymes, but also betaine hydrochloric acid, which just helps with that stomach acid needed to break down those proteins, minerals, and vitamin B12. We also included bile salt, and this helps to emulsify the fats. So the next thing we looked at doing is helping to stimulate peristalsis. In the able-bodied individuals, eating stimulates the gastrocolic reflex, which helps to move food matter through the intestine so that it can be eliminated. Studies show that individuals with SCI still retain this response. Therefore, each time we eat, this reflex is triggered and movement through the intestines occurs. Therefore, eating smaller, more frequent meals can help stimulate this reflex and peristalsis. You can take advantage of this reflex by drinking warm fluids or eating 30 minutes before a bowel routine. We also looked at reducing refined carbohydrates and foods high in the glycemic index. This is so important for spinal cord injury due to their difficulties with carbohydrate metabolism and the high risk of insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes. But from a digestive perspective, these foods can actually slow the motility of the intestine tract. When blood sugar is raised too quickly, as in the case with our client's current diet, the sections of the small intestines, such as the duodenum and the jejunum, begin to propel the digested matter through them much slower rate. This is because these foods, such as white rice, white pasta, white bread, can actually act like a glue in the gut, and this becomes very sticky. This is what causes the bowel transit time to slow down. In fact, processed white bread, which contains very little fiber, was used to treat diarrhea back in the 1800s because it was so effective at clogging up the colon. We also want to look at increasing fiber. We all know that fiber plays a critical role in helping to prevent and relieve constipation. This is because fiber absorbs water and adds bulk to the stools and makes them more slippery, soft, and pliable, which helps to get it moving through the digestive tract. It is recommended for the able-bodied population that they should be consuming approximately 35 grams of fiber a day. However, for the spinal cord injury populations, studies recommend that this should be between 19 and 30 grams of fiber a day. And any more or less, this can actually slow that bowel transit time down. In fact, there was a study done on fiber and SCI, and it showed that when individuals with SCI consume between that 19 and 30 grams of fiber a day, they had decreased bowel transit time, increased the amount of stool being passed during a bowel routine, and they had a better stool consistency, which can help reduce bowel accidents. Ideally, when you're increasing a person's fiber, you want a combination of soluble and insoluble fiber. So soluble fiber helps to form a gel-like substance that helps prevent and alleviate constipation. And this is done by making the stool softer, moister, and more pliable. This can be found in beans, peas, oats, berries, and legumes. Black beans especially are great because they are high in magnesium, which is a natural muscle relaxant, and can also help to loosen that hardened stool. Insoluble fiber passes through the intestines relatively unchanged and adds bulk to the stools, which can help push matter through your colon and relieve constipation. So these foods can be found in whole grains, such as wild and brown rice, and many fruits and vegetables with their skins on, such as sweet potatoes. So if you have a hard time getting enough fiber in your diet, we also look at supplementing, which was what we did with this client case. So we supplemented with 1 tablespoon of whole husk psyllium a day, but you can use other options as well, such as chia seeds or flax seeds. Just wanted to point out that if you are going to use a fiber supplement, you need to do it 2 hours before or after taking medications and other supplements. This is because the fiber absorbs these substances, which are then eliminated from the body, and therefore this can reduce their desired effectiveness in the body. And when we increase fiber, we always need to increase fluid intake. If someone doesn't like water, you can always look at drinking herbal teas, broths, diluted juices, especially prune juice and apricot nectar, and lemon juice and water. Fresh ginger tea is great because it actually can help stimulate the digestive enzymes. Next thing we wanted to do is looking at increasing good fats. So good fats such as omega-3 can help to lubricate the bowel and soften hardened stool. They act as a natural stool softener without the negative side effects of pharmaceutical ones. Essential fats cannot be made from the body, and therefore we have to get it from food sources. So good sources of these fats include oily fish such as tuna, salmon, mackerel, pickerel, herring, and also to olives and olive oil. Ideally, you're looking at 1 tablespoon of olive oil a day. This also has the added bonus of supporting cardiovascular health and weight loss as well. Also, flaxseed oil is great. You can put that on your salad dressings. But with this client, we also put them on a fish oil supplement. So we looked at 2 to 4 pills, and these were 1,000 milligrams each. We have noticed that when we increase their intake of essential omega-3 with our clients, that they also are able to reduce their stool softeners as well. And it is important to note that fish oils are a natural blood thinner, so you need to stop taking fish oils before undergoing surgery. And if you are on blood thinning medication, you should consult with your family physician first. So the next thing we looked at doing is putting them on probiotics. We have trillions of bacteria living in our large intestine that help assist us with proper bowel function. The 2 major strains include Lactobacillus acidophilus and Bifidobacterium. These good bacteria help to ferment fiber found in your digested matter, which help to produce fuel for your cells of your colon. These bacteria also help to maintain the health and function of your bowels, and maintaining a healthy gut flora can help enhance that peristalsis and help prevent constipation. To get probiotics from food sources, it is important to consume fermented foods, such as plain unsweetened yogurt, kefir, sauerkraut, miso, and pickled foods. Usually our clients cannot get enough of the good bacteria from food alone, especially if someone is constipated or especially if they've been on antibiotics. So in this case, we put them on a probiotic supplement. The minimum that we recommend is about 8 billion active cultures, although we often go a lot higher than this, especially if they've been on antibiotics. And it should contain the Lactobacillus acidophilus and Bifidobacterium. If someone has completed a course of antibiotics, you need to use probiotics for at least 2 to 3 months. And ideally, you want to be looking at purchasing freeze-dried probiotics, as this keeps the flora dormant until it enters the body. You want to keep your probiotics in the fridge. And if you are on antibiotics, you can take probiotics, but it is recommended that you take them two hours apart from each other. So the outcome of this client, after we put him on the plan, 3 months later, he was having a bowel motion every day, so that was a big improvement from going once every 3 days. He had a much faster, more efficient bowel routine. His reduced incidences of embarrassing, loud, and foul-smelling gas. He no longer had abdominal pain. He had increased energy, and he was no longer having those afternoon naps. And with this obviously came increased self-esteem and mood. He no longer avoided going out or being in social gatherings, and he actually started dating. And ironically, he did date a girl that did not eat healthy, and he had to break up with her because he was so on board with eating healthy. She was just messing with that. And he just returned from the 2014 Paralympics with a bronze medal. So it was really, really great. And now I'm going to pass over to Joe, who will present on a client case who developed a stage 4 pressure sore.
Okay, so pressure sores, we know, is a very serious and unfortunately common secondary health complication. People with spinal cord injuries have an 85 to 95% risk of developing them, so very high over your lifetime. And once you've had a pressure sore, your skin is only 80% of its original integrity, so you're at high risk again of getting another pressure sore in the same area. Also, risk of getting a pressure sore increases with time since injury. They account for a very high number of rehospitalizations. Pressure sores put tremendous stress on the body and can contribute to other health issues and complications such as chronic fatigue, infections such as osteomyelitis, which can be life-threatening, autonomic dysreflexia, spasticity, and if they involve prolonged bed rest, which some of them do, 1, 2, 3 years sometimes for some people, this can then lead to overall body weakness, atrophy of muscles, interfere with education, employment, social life, overall quality of life, and in some cases, it can lead to depression. There are numerous factors that contribute to pressure sore development and why we are so at risk of getting them after injury. I want to go through some of them because they're good to be aware of in helping you to prevent them. One is altered circulation. Reduced circulation below the level of injury can compromise the supply of oxygen and essential nutrients to tissues. Additionally, below the level of injury, the tone and closing pressure of your blood vessels is less than it was pre-injury, and when your blood vessels remain more dilated, it can lead to waste buildup, which in turn makes them more susceptible to breakdown and damage. There's also altered collagen production below the level of injury. This can lead to decreased skin strength, which in turn can increase risk of skin injury and impair healing. Atrophy, of course, we all know wasted muscle tissue, particularly over those bony prominences, can increase risk. Body weight is an issue, whether you're overweight or underweight. Over 65% of people with spinal cord injuries, as I was saying earlier, are overweight. When you have an increase in weight, you have an increase in pressure over certain parts of your body. But also if you're underweight, and you have little padding under your tissue, that also can lead to skin breakdown. So it's so important for people with spinal cord injuries to maintain an ideal weight. Of course, changes in body positioning, seating, due to things like joint contractures or pelvic obliquity can lead to increase in pressure and pressure sores. Excessive moisture can also cause skin breakdown. Excessive moisture due to sweat, urine, and or feces. Heat is another issue. There is a significant rise in skin temperature within 2 to 5 minutes of transferring into your wheelchair around the tail and sit bones. And this increase in temperature can make the skin more prone to damage. And as higher temperatures, it also, when you get these higher temperatures, it increases your tissue's needs for oxygen. So when you get this increase in need for oxygen, it also leads to more skin breakdown, which is an ideal breeding ground for bacteria, which in turn can lead to skin breakdown and poor wound healing. So there's a lot of kind of domino effects going on here, as you can hear. Immune function is another issue. There's altered communication between your nervous, endocrine, and immune systems after injury. And this is associated with blood vessel function, and it can impair your body's ability to fight off infections, which are often associated with pressure sores. Of course, loss of sensation and movement and your ability to move and reposition yourself can lead to increase in pressure sore risk. Spasms is another one. This increased friction that can happen can increase risk, especially around things like your ankles, okay? Thinning skin is another one, and this speaks to that increased risk of time since injury. Thinning skin, unfortunately, is a natural aging process that happens to all of us, because what happens when your skin does get older, it loses elasticity, it loses strength, and then has a decreased supply of oxygen and essential nutrients. And the last one I want to talk about, something we're talking about here tonight, malnutrition. As I was mentioning off the top of the presentation, people with spinal cord injuries are at risk for a lot of nutrient deficiencies, and in particular, the ones with skin strength and integrity are vitamins A, C, E, and the mineral zinc, which we all tend to be deficient in post-injury. Studies show, the good news though, early nutritional intervention can enhance your immune system to help fight off infections that may be associated with pressure sores. It can lower the risk of associated complications, decrease length of hospital stays, and improve wound healing time. So, the client case for pressure sores that I'm going to talk about right now involves a 47-year-old C4-5 incomplete quadriplegic. At 25 years post-injury, he developed his first pressure sore on his sacrum. So you can see that increased risk with time since injury speaks very much to this. At 25 years, he got his first pressure sore. At 9 months of trying to stay off of his skin as much as possible, dressing it every day, it still at 9 months progressed to stage 4, which is severe. It was 4 inches long, 4.5 inches wide, and 3.5 inches deep. Serious pressure sore. At 9 months, he then developed osteomyelitis, requiring surgery. After surgery, the wound was healing slowly, but not fast enough for what his physicians would have liked, so they started using vacuum therapy on him. But even after a few months of that, it wasn't healing quick enough, and he was getting it measured every 2 weeks by his physicians, and they were measuring that it was healing 5% every 2 weeks. It was at this time that they highly suggested to him to get on a specialized diet to increase his healing time. And that's when he came to us. And here's the protocol that we gave to him. Number one, increase calories. Individuals with pressure sores often show signs of malnutrition, because pressure sores compete with the body for energy stores and amino acids, so your body requires nutritional support. To provide your body with the raw materials it needs to build collagen, rebuild that skin, but also boost your immune system to help fight off any infections associated with them. If calorie needs are not met, it can lead to a catabolic state and the loss of precious tissue, which we can't afford to lose any more tissue. It can lead to weight loss, a weakened immune system. So to meet the body's increased energy needs required to help the body heal, you need to increase calories. I do want to note here that when Kylie and I work with clients, we create personalized nutritional protocols for the individual needs of each and every client. There is research that shows and indicates increasing calories, 30 to 35 calories per kilogram of body weight, can help the pressure sore heal. There's newer research also that does indicate increasing calories may not be necessary for certain individuals, because you need to be careful, it may contribute to unnecessary weight gain, which is another huge secondary health complication. This particular client did not have any weight issues, so we increased his calories, 30 to 35 calories per kilogram of body weight. When you're increasing calories, though, it doesn't mean to go through the drive-thru. You want to make sure that you are increasing your calories with healthy, nutrient-dense sources. And here's some great ideas for you. Nuts, nut butters, so things like almonds, almond butter, it's great. Dried fruits or fruit juices, real fruit juices, not any of the fruit drinks that are out there. Make sure it's a pure source. Avocados are wonderful. Whole grain carbohydrates, very important. You want to make sure you're getting those whole grains in there as an energy source for your body, so that your body can preserve the protein you're giving it to build the collagen, heal the wound, build new tissue. Coconut milk is another great source of calories, healthy calories. One can of coconut milk can have as much as 500 calories. So throw this in your smoothies, your soups, your curries. Get those calories up. The other beautiful thing about coconut products is coconuts are natural antimicrobials, so they can help support the immune system at the same time. So that's great. Okay, number two, increased this individual's protein. Protein, of course, I was just saying, essential for the growth and repair of new tissue. It is recommended to increase your protein from 0.8 grams of protein per kilogram of body weight to 1.2 to 1.5 grams of protein per kilogram of body weight. Great sources: fish, lean beef, lean chicken, quinoa, lentils, legumes, wonderful, nuts and seeds, great protein sources. It is often difficult, though, for individuals to eat the recommended amount of protein that we're suggesting, so often it's easier to drink the protein in the form of a protein powder, protein smoothie, protein shake, and just drink it throughout the day. There's three amino acids here that you can note on the slide with the stars beside them. These three amino acids, by the way, are the building blocks of proteins. These three amino acids have an affinity for healing, so you want to make sure you're getting these ones in your system: lysine, proline, and glutamine. And you can get these from chicken, turkey, cottage cheese, beef, and legumes, beans. We also have this individual take supplements of these particular amino acids, okay? Number three, the next thing we did for him is ensure he was getting lots of foods that were rich in vitamins A, C, E, and the mineral zinc. Vitamin A stimulates growth of the base layer of the skin. It also enhances the activity of white blood cells to help protect against infection. So get lots of vitamin A-rich foods in the diet. Yellow and orange vegetables are great sources. Sweet potato is a great example. Vitamin C helps convert the amino acids I was just mentioning, proline and lysine, into collagen. It also helps strengthen blood vessels to help support circulation to deliver the necessary nutrients to the wound site. It also helps support the immune system by helping activate white blood cells. The other thing too is prolonged physical stress. Kylie talked earlier about stress. Physical stress, pressure sores are a form of physical stress, and stress depletes the system of vitamin C. So you want to make sure you're giving your body lots of foods that are rich in vitamin C. Great sources are green leafy vegetables, broccoli, green and red peppers, and of course the citrus fruits, which we all know. Vitamin E is a powerful antioxidant that helps protect tissues. So sunflower seeds, olives, olive oil, great sources of vitamin E. Zinc, the mineral zinc, is necessary for tissue formation, skin elasticity, and repair, and also supports the immune system. Pumpkin seeds are a great form of zinc. Snack on those throughout the day. We also had this individual take supplements of all of these nutrients to make sure he was getting enough all day. Okay, so here are the dosages of these nutrients that we were giving him. Vitamin A, 5,000 international units a day. Vitamin C, 3,000 milligrams a day, and divided doses throughout the day. It is a water-soluble vitamin, so you do excrete it throughout the day, so you want to keep it up in your system. And it's also great to get vitamin C with flavonoids. Flavonoids are what make our fruits and vegetables nice and bright. So these help your body absorb vitamin C when you can get vitamin C with the flavonoids. Vitamin E, 400 international units a day, and the zinc, 50 milligrams a day. We do recommend that you only supplement with zinc for up to a maximum of 8 weeks, or if your pressure sore heals before then, stop taking it when it's actually closed over and healed. The reason for this is that excess zinc in your system can inhibit iron and copper absorption. The next thing we had this individual do was drink at least 8 cups of fluid a day. So water, especially water with lemon. Lemon, again, with vitamin C, helps boost the immune system. Herbal teas. You need fluids, at least 8 cups a day, to help carry important repair substances to the wound site. Also helps get rid of wastes and toxins that may be associated with infection that may be associated with the wound. In addition to herbal teas, lemon water, we also recommended that he drink coconut water. Again, here comes the coconut product. Reason for this is chronic pressure sores actually deplete your body of electrolytes. Electrolytes, minerals, things like potassium and sodium. Very important to make sure this is not depleted in your system. Coconut water is a natural source of electrolytes, so you can drink this throughout the day. The next thing that we did is have him eat lots of good fats. Good fats, omega-3s, are very important for proper cell reproduction. They help reduce inflammation, therefore support the healing process. They help maintain skin integrity and elasticity of the skin. They also help prevent moisture loss, which can contribute to skin breakdown. And the other thing about good fats is you need fats in your system to carry 4 fat-soluble vitamins throughout your system. 2 of the 4 fat-soluble vitamins are very important for skin healing. I've already talked about them, vitamin A and vitamin E. So where can you get good fats? Fish, salmon, things like sardines, halibut. Walnuts are another great source. Ground flax seeds are great as well. You want to be eating fish 2 to 4 times a week. If you know you're not, you don't like fish, then we recommend taking omega-3 fish oil supplements. 2 to 4 1,000 milligrams a day. I do want to stress again, as Kylie mentioned earlier, they are a natural blood thinner, so if you're on any blood thinning medication, always consult with your physician first before taking them. The outcome of doing this, within the first 4 weeks of incorporating the foods and all the supplements into his diet, is that his healing time doubled from 5 to 10% every 2 weeks. Within 6 months, his wound was completely healed, and he was able to return to work full time. This individual worked in the financial industry, worked full time, he loved his job, he was so highly motivated to get back to work. So for him, it was just so important. So he was absolutely thrilled. So those are the 2 client cases that we want to talk to you about tonight. And we've given you the specific recommendations for those. But we also want to cover just a general diet. Because often a question we get asked is, I don't have a specific health condition, a secondary issue. What do I need to do to just maintain my health every single day and prevent any of the secondary complications that, you know, I'm at high risk for developing down the road? So what we want to go over next is just a daily diet for you, what you need to get into your diet every day to help maintain your health, okay? So what we're looking at doing here for maintenance, protein. You want to look at eating 2 to 3 servings of protein every day. What is a protein serving? We all have a built-in protein meter in our hand. If everybody looks at their hand, without your thumb, without your fingers, the palm of your hand is a protein serving. So it's actually not a lot. If you look at getting 2 to 3 of those in your diet every day to maintain your skin, your immune system, that's all it is. Have a little bit for breakfast, a little bit for lunch, a little bit for dinner. Help balance your blood sugars, your insulin levels. It's also going to help support your skin and your immune system. Okay? The next thing, fruits. You want to get 1 to 2 fruits max a day into your diet to help provide yourself with the essential vitamins, minerals, and fiber that you need. We don't recommend any more than 2 fruits a day because they do have sugars in them. They're natural sugars, which are great, but you want to not overdo it because, again, 65% of people with spinal cord injuries tend to be overweight, so you want to maintain a healthy weight. All right. You want to avoid also the tropical fruits in particular. These are very high in sugars, things like pineapple, papaya, mangoes, okay? The next one, and this is a big one, grains. We only recommend 1 serving of grain a day. That equals 1 slice of whole grain bread or a 1/2 cup of brown rice or whole grain pasta, things like spelt pasta, kamut pasta. Why are we only recommending 1 serving? A couple of reasons here. Grains are acidifying and inflammatory foods, which means they cause tissue inflammation. And this is a problem for people with spinal cord injuries because we tend to be systematically inflamed due to stress and or medications and or a poor diet. And when tissues get inflamed, they are weaker and more susceptible to breakdown and infection. As well, too many grains can contribute to weight gain, which I've mentioned numerous times now. The other thing, as Kylie talked about earlier when she was covering constipation, is the processed grains, the white bread, the white pasta, can contribute to constipation, and that kind of gluey stickiness in the gut slow down your bowel routines. people are often really concerned, and they say, well, if I'm only having one serving of grain a day, what am I going to eat? I'm not going to have enough energy. You can get plenty of good carbohydrates and energy from foods like fruits, vegetables, legumes, lentils. These are great sources of healthy carbohydrates to provide your body with lots of energy. And so speaking of legumes and lentils, what we recommend is you get two servings of these a day. And these have not only great carbohydrates, healthy carbohydrates, but they also have protein in them.
Right, so the next one is vegetables. So we want to look at getting about five or more servings of vegetables a day. So a serving size, you're looking at about half a cup. So good vegetable sources, like we love our cruciferous vegetables, so these are things like your broccoli, your cabbage, and your cauliflower. These are great because they really support the liver, and the liver can get quite burdened from all the use of medications that people with SCI are on. The liver is also the key fat-burning organ in the body, so taking care of the liver can help with managing weight as well. Asparagus is great. It's actually very important for bladder health. Sweet potato is good. It's high in that beta-carotene, so good for the immune system. You got your beets and your carrots and lots of dark leafy greens. And celery is great. In fact, you actually burn more calories consuming celery than what is actually in it. And that is because it takes so much energy for your digestive system to break down those tough fibers that it's actually a really great weight loss vegetable. So lots of celery. The other thing is fats. You want to look at two servings of healthy fats a day. A serving size is about one tablespoon of oil or a golf ball size of nuts. Olives and olive oil are great. It's important when cooking with olive oil that you want to cook on lower heats, because if you cook with olive oil on higher heats, it actually causes those good fats to go rancid. Avocados, as Joe was mentioning before, are great. You can put them in salads and smoothies, and it gives it that nice creamy texture in the smoothies. It's also high in those B vitamins, which is good for energy. Flax seeds is great. You can put them in your shakes or sprinkle them on your oatmeal. And coconut oil is also good. I use that instead of butter when I'm doing baking. And coconut oil is a healthy oil, and it's a great oil to cook with on high heats as well. Raw and unsalted nuts and seeds, such as almonds, walnuts, Brazil nuts, pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds. You want to stay away from peanuts and pistachios. They are high on the allergenic profile, and they also tend to be high in mold, and that is not good for gut health. The other thing we want to look at is fluids. So you want to be looking at drinking between 6 to 8 cups of fluids a day, and one cup is equivalent to 8 ounces. So if you don't like drinking water, you can always drink herbal teas. Green tea is great because it's got that small amount of caffeine to give you that little bit of a boost. But it also has an amino acid in it called L-theanine, which provides more of a calming energy than the jittery energy that caffeine and coffee can give you. It also has antioxidants, and it also has fat-burning properties as well. Water with freshly squeezed lemon juice actually helps to alkalize the body. It stimulates digestion, and it also contains vitamin C to support the immune system. You also have your diluted juices. And broths and soups are great because not only do they contain a lot of water, but it also helps you to get those 5+ servings of vegetables in that you need. And also it's really cheap as well. And a person or caregiver can make it in bulk and pre-freeze it into portion sizes. And so the person can just go and heat it up in the microwave. So the things to avoid, you want to avoid refined carbohydrates. Due to the difficulties with carbohydrate metabolism, a person with SCI needs to be avoiding the white bread, the white rice, the white pasta, the cookies, the cakes, the bagels, all the good stuff. You want to get rid of trans fats. Trans fats are used to increase the shelf life of foods. So they can be found in salad dressings, deep fried foods, frozen dinners, commercial baked goods. Trans fats actually block the conversion of those essential good fats into those vital brain fats such as gamma linoleic acid and DHA. You want to avoid sugar and artificial sweeteners. Sugar actually has a very similar chemical structure to vitamin C, and that actually competes for absorption into the cell. And don't think you're doing any favors to switching to artificial sweeteners, because studies show that artificial sweeteners can actually increase appetite and increase weight gain, cause weight gain. You also want to look at limiting alcohol, because this contains sugar and can actually depress the immune system as well. And limit caffeine. This can place stress on the adrenals, which can raise cortisol levels. Excess cortisol can contribute to that nice tire around the belly. It also affects the blood levels as well, blood fat levels. And of course, you want to avoid soda. Soda is high in phosphorus, which is not good for bone health. And just one can of Coke contains 10 teaspoons of sugar.
In terms of supplements to maintain your everyday health, what we recommend is a good professional brand, multivitamin, to help ensure you're getting all your nutritional needs every day. Vitamin C to help support skin integrity, your immune system. Vitamin C is also very important in liver detoxification, which is extremely important because after spinal cord injury, people are often taking medications on a long-term basis. So you want to make sure these are being detoxified every single day. We also recommend omega-3 fatty acid to support your cardiovascular health, reduce inflammation, maintain skin integrity, and make those bowel routines more efficient, more effective. A good probiotic supplement, as Kylie was mentioning earlier, with a minimum of 8 billion active microorganisms, support the immune system and again support bowel function. And vitamin D we recommend for supporting bone health. And what we've done next here is, you know, we've given you a ton of information tonight. What do I do with all this? What am I supposed to eat? Where do I start? What we've given you here is a weekly menu, a sample plan. This can help you get started. For those of you who have the handouts here, you can see them all. This is just a really simple, easy menu plan for you. So this is where you can get started.
So just in closing, nutrition is and needs to be an integral part of the rehabilitation process. It's important for helping to prevent, manage, and reduce secondary health complications, and it is key in optimizing long-term health and well-being. But it is important to acknowledge that more research is needed to explore how nutrition can help SCI with maximizing overall health and reducing those secondary health complications. So the simple question that Joe had mentioned before is not just to ask your patient or client, what are you taking, but you also need to consider and ask them, what are you eating? Thank you.
If anybody has any questions, just raise your hand and I'll bring the mic over to you.
Well, my question is, for 15 years I've had IBS, and I've been from one doctor to another, and nobody knows what to do about it. So now I'm very, very underweight, like I'm like 65 pounds. So do you have any recommendations for IBS, because right now I'm afraid to eat anything. Okay.
Gluten. So one thing we'd recommend is to stay away from gluten-based foods. So that's your wheat. Things like rice is better to consume. Buckwheat. But I would be staying away from the dairy and the gluten because they can be very inflammatory and can really irritate the bowel.
Have you also tried a gut healing protocol? So taking fish oils, probiotics, as well as glutamine, the amino acid I was saying that has an affinity for healing. Glutamine can also help heal the gut, calm it down if it's very inflamed, very agitated. So together with the anti-inflammatory foods that Kylie mentioned, with a good gut healing protocol, can help with the IBS. And are you drinking a lot of your calories now? No? It might also be something you might want to consider to get the calories in, because it just puts less burden on your stomach to break it down and absorb nutrients. So that might be something else.
Hi, thank you. It's very informative. Is on all the stuff you're recommending, are you recommending for men or women? Because there's definitely going to be a difference for some of the things. That's my question as a woman, especially with menopause coming up and everything. Is there a section in your book maybe that would be in there?
When it comes to weight, absolutely. We will look men, women differently and in different weight categories. Again, we were saying we create personalized protocols. So for women, hormone balancing and hormones tend to get out of balance after spinal cord injury. So that's absolutely something that could be looked at.
Hello?
Oh, hi. We have a question from the webcast. And one question is, besides D-mannose, what other foods and nutritional supplements do you recommend for bladder health and UTI prevention?
Probiotics, absolutely. D-mannose, love it. There's been some great studies done and its effectiveness for helping reduce bladder infections. What we do recommend with D-mannose, if anybody here is not familiar with that, it's a sugar molecule that's shown great effectiveness for helping reduce bladder infections. When you actually have a bladder infections without any kind of blood in the urine, any fever, we recommend taking 1 teaspoon every 3 to 4 hours for 2 to 3 days, and then take 1 teaspoon every day for maintenance. And if you can combine that with taking a good probiotic supplement, we both mentioned earlier a minimum of 8 billion active microorganisms. If you have chronic bladder infections, I would recommend going as high as 50 billion. You can even go as high as 100. Taking a probiotic supplement every day can really help boost your immune system as well as change the acidity level in your tissues to help fight off bacterial infection.
And some good foods are asparagus, watermelon, cranberry juice, but also blueberry juice is good too. Okay.
And stop eating sugar.
Yeah.
Sugar feeds bacteria. So you're only making your infection stronger if you're eating sugar throughout the day or drinking anything with sugar in it. What's also interesting is 1 teaspoon of sugar reduces your white blood cell production for 4 hours after 1 teaspoon. So for some people who are drinking, eating sugar all day long, you're constantly suppressing your immune system. Get it out of your diet.
Thank you. And one quick question, I'll hand over the mic then. Do you have any daily calorie limits that you recommend for people?
We don't focus on calories. We focus on nutrient-dense whole foods. That's our focus, yeah.
Two items that I use that I'm wondering what your opinions are is kombucha tea, and also cranberry supplements, high dose cranberry concentrate.
For bladder infections, cranberries, for some people with the clients that I've worked with, cranberry juice, pills can be very effective at helping to fight bladder infections. For others, it doesn't do anything. So I think you've got to try whatever might be helpful. If you're finding it helpful, great, keep taking it. For anybody who finds that the cranberry juice, cranberry pills isn't working, then maybe try the D-mannose and the kombucha tea. Wonderful. Amazing. Great stuff. Keep drinking it. Great to boost the immune system and get, it's a fermented drink, if anybody's not familiar with it. Great for getting those natural probiotics in your system and boosting your immune system.
Thank you. Do you have any suggestions for the quad belly?
Well, definitely trying to reduce stress as much as possible, because stress raises cortisol. So any stress reduction techniques or relaxation techniques. The other thing is balancing blood sugars. So eating every 2 to 3 hours, protein, good fats, they don't raise blood sugar. When your blood sugars drop, if you've had like a can of pop and a pizza, your blood sugars skyrocket, and what goes up comes crashing down. So when your blood sugars drop, your body naturally produces cortisol to raise blood sugars back up. So that's one way, and excess cortisol, as I was mentioning in the presentation, it actually contributes to the tire. So that would be one thing. And then obviously with regards to the constipation, the digestive stuff, is following that regime as well.
Thank you. And can you explain why artificial sweeteners cause weight gain?
It actually creates, it changes like the brain chemistry and causes you to be hungry. It actually increases appetite, what causes you to want to consume excess calories.
For those of us who are active, what do you recommend for, say, after a workout or a sporting event for high glycemic index foods? Do you recommend we stay away from them totally, or is it okay for any time after we're exercising? And if so, what kinds of foods, like bananas that are ripened a lot, or should we stay away from potatoes, or what do you suggest?
I think it depends on the individual and it depends on the exercise. So lifting heavy weights versus like endurance. If you're doing more endurance things, then your cells become more sensitive to glucose, so they're going to open up more and let that sugar go in. But I do think it's a case-by-case basis. Potatoes, I'd much rather you go for sweet potatoes. Actual white potatoes have a chemical in it called solanin, which is a natural pesticide, and that actually can cause a lot of inflammation to the joints. But I don't know if you have...
A post-workout prunes. With an hour of working out, get a good protein smoothie with, you know, say, whey protein powder. It's very well absorbed, but throw that banana in there, get the good carbs in there. That's what we recommend.
And also, too, like L-glutamine for muscle recovery. And if you are looking for body compensation, then you're doing like the branched chain amino acids.
And stay away from the sport aid drinks, full of artificial flavors, artificial colors, high in sodium. Coconut water, again, great source of those natural electrolytes, and it's a great way to just cool down after a good workout and replace those electrolytes.
Another to add to that, you can do your homemade drinks, recovery drinks. So that would be, say, like a liter of water with a tablespoon of maple syrup and a pinch of salt, or a liter of water with a cup of orange juice and a pinch of salt, some salt.
Thank you.
We do have several more questions on the webcast, if we have time. And one question is, are there specific foods or nutrients to foster neuron regeneration?
There has been, that's a great question. There has been no research that I'm aware of that has been done on this. I mean, this is one of the reasons why we want to come out and do these talks, is to encourage people to maybe consider nutrition specific to nerve health. I mean, the nerve is made up of key nutrients. So the myelin sheath that surrounds the nerve is made up of B12, folic acid, so those good fish oils, the DHA. The electrical impulse that runs through the nerve is made up of sodium and potassium. So those are some key nutrients, and that would be the key nutrients for nerve health. And lecithin. Lecithin helps to make up part of the myelin sheath that surrounds the nerve.
And you can get lecithin in eggs. Eggs are a great brain food. So, yeah, don't be afraid of eating the eggs. They're great. Good protein, low calories, and great for the brain.
And they don't raise cholesterol.
Well, maybe you could tell us a little bit about how you feel about a ketogenic diet. It's used for MS patients, and some SCI patients believe in it as well. That's another question.
The ketogenic diet, so like a high protein. Anything that's too extreme, I would be concerned about. Like as Joe had mentioned in the slide, with spinal cord injury, they're so prone to nutrient deficiencies, so you need a well-balanced diet. I'd be curious as to why they would be put on that, if there was a specific reason. And obviously that's very taxing on the kidneys. And spinal cord injury can have a lot of problems with the kidneys too. So I would be concerned about doing more of those extreme diets.
If someone was going to partake in that kind of diet, then definitely balance it out with lots of green leafy vegetables. Because of the ammonia that can be produced, which is what Kylie was mentioning about being hard in the kidneys, if you're going to have a very high protein diet, always balance it with lots of green leafy vegetables, at least 5 servings, as Kylie said earlier, vegetables a day. And if you cannot prepare that amount of vegetables, you don't want to eat that much, it's a lot of chewing, then we recommend drinking it with a good greens drink, okay, to alkalinize the body.
And lots of water as well.
Thank you. And if there aren't other questions in the room, we have another question. Is there? I'm sorry. We'll give you a chance, and we have more.
Thank you so much. I'm from China, and I'm a doctor in spinal cord injury for over 10 years. Usually in my clinical practice, I just focus on the activity of daily living and neurological recovery. So this is first time I begin to pay attention to the nutrition. You know, in China, a lot of patients, they are receiving the vitamin B12 injection. So this is supposed to be have some function in the neurological recovery, but I'm not sure. Because you have mentioned the vitamin, I think you have mentioned the vitamin C and vitamin D. I suppose they are useful in such as the pressure sore prevention and osteoporosis of spinal cord injury. But do you have some articles or evidence to show that vitamin B12 is deficient in after spinal cord injury patients? I think maybe this is should be tested if they are deficient.
So I actually mentioned in my presentation that there is a research study, and if it's not on the slides, I can give it to you because I think I have that one. And it's in our chapter on anemia about the B12 deficiency, that even when the spinal cord injury wasn't diagnosed with the deficiency, they still had improvements in neurological health from having a supplement of B12. And that's where they came with the conclusion that the deficiency should have a lower threshold than the able-bodied population. B12 is a very big molecule, and it's very hard to break down and digest. So they are more at risk of a B12 deficiency, for sure. But I have got the research. I can give it to you afterwards, the actual study.
I'm sorry. Does any kind of food that are, rich of the vitamin B12?
Red meat.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But you do definitely want to support digestive function as well, because you're not going to be breaking it down, absorbing it, if you've got digestive issues, which so many people with spinal cord injuries do. So you want to make sure that maybe you're coupling that, eating the beef, with a good digestive enzyme to make sure it's broken down properly and absorbed properly.
Okay, and also I'm from China, from Beijing to here. I just want to make a lot of friends here. I'm just focused on spinal cord injury treatment. My center is the biggest one in China. We have almost 500 beds for spinal cord injury. So, I just want to know more about the spinal cord injury to care for the patients. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was an excellent presentation. I'd like to share with you from an herbal perspective. A lot of the stuff you covered are things that we research and try to understand ourselves. I'd like to share with you something that I found very helpful whenever I had bouts of dysentery, and I can understand somebody locked in a position where they can't help themselves, a handful of blueberries and blackberries, which sounds counterproductive, may shut it down just like that. And concerning the nerves, the regeneration of the nerves, the firing, the synapses, and all that stuff, things like colloidal gold, colloidal platinum. There have been many studies that have been done on these products that will actually show they've helped the firing. They help rebuild the nerves. The platinum is very productive in helping restore memory. And there are also other tinctures and things like this which are very beneficial for bed sores, which will bring the sore under control, and then also comfrey or other herbs that will actually bring about a more complete healing so that it doesn't reestablish itself. So thank you, but I think this was an excellent presentation, and I thank you for sharing the way you did, what you did.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Hi, you talked about artificial sweeteners, but I was wondering what you thought of stevia, if you approve of it or not.
Oh, absolutely. Stevia, for those of you who aren't familiar, is a plant. They take the leaves and either crush them down into a powder, which you can use as a sweetener, or you can get it into an extract and just little drops and put it into, you know, your coffee or anything else that you might sweeten. And the leaves of the plant are 200 times sweeter than sugar, so you only need a little bit. There's no calories, so it's wonderful. So absolutely, stevia is wonderful. I find with people it's a love or hate thing, though. Either love it or you hate it. So definitely try it, though. Highly recommend it.
And the great thing about stevia is it doesn't raise blood sugars like the sugar does.
What do you think of mate? It comes from South America. It's a caffeine drink, like coffee or tea.
Mate?
That's pretty high in caffeine, so that's going to raise that cortisol levels. So, yeah, I would tend to go for the green tea. Yeah.
I had a question. Is there any good to Chinese or Thai food? Because when I eat Thai food, I feel wonderful.
Right. Thai food, it is wonderful. It is delicious.
But it's bad.
You do need to be careful because it can raise blood sugars very quickly, a lot of the noodles. And so, you know, just make sure you get some nice salads in there as well and good fiber to slow the absorption of those blood sugars. And just you need to be careful, too, when you're having any kind of fast food. A lot MSG, the artificial flavors, colorings, again, they can be very irritating to the nervous system, and many people find that when they have fast foods, a lot of these food additives can actually set off neuropathic pain. So for anybody who experiences neuropathic pain, which is I'm sure many people here who are here in the room tonight are watching, you might want to try eliminating some artificial flavors, colorings, food additives, and see if it helps to reduce your neuropathic pain.
I had just one more question. Do you have any information about aspartame? Because a friend of mine, she drank 6 glasses of Diet Coke for 33 years, and now all of a sudden she can't walk anymore, and they say it's because of the aspartame. It's in the soda.
Yeah, like sugar in general, in higher doses can actually be toxic to the nerve cells, and actually they are coining Alzheimer's as type 3 diabetes because having too much sugar in the blood can have huge problems with neurological conditions, etc. And especially with artificial sweeteners, I mean, they can be carcinogenics as well. So yeah, sorry to hear that.
For nerve pain, a supplement for nerve pain.
A great supplement is curcumin, or the spice turmeric is great for reducing inflammation. So, you know, start cooking with turmeric, or if you don't like it, then you can actually get a supplement of curcumin, take it in divided doses throughout the day, and it can have a great effect at reducing pain.
And also capsaicin, found in chili peppers. Capsaicin stops this chemical substance P, which actually causes it's a chemical that travels to the brain to cause register pain. So like chili peppers, cayenne pepper is also good for nerve pain.
And if we have time for one more question. Do you have any comments regarding Dr. Terry Wall's diet for feeding your mitochondria for chronic immune disease?
Heard of that.
We're actually not familiar with that particular diet, so no.
It's interesting, though. We'll have to look into that.
Then I'll ask one more question, and we'll check up. We'll get some resources on that. But do you have any suggestions for people who suffer incontinence and should be drinking enough? They think they are drinking enough. So people who are drinking enough and are dealing with incontinence. They have to drink enough for other reasons.
Is it incontinence or is it like diarrhea?
Incontinence. I couldn't say, but if somebody on the chat wants to give us some
bladder
more information.
Bladder incontinence or bowel incontinence? Bladder or bowel incontinence?
Sounds like bladder.
I couldn't say, but I will send an email to the chat and get more information.
Yeah, if you're losing a lot of fluids, then you want to be replacing your electrolytes. So again, what Joe was mentioning, like the coconut water is great.
Great.
If that's what the question was meaning. Yeah.
Thank you.
No, it's in the book.
It's your famous turmeric.
Yeah, turmeric.
Thank you so much for all the great questions. I just want to have a reminder that if you could fill out our surveys that we provide you with so we can improve and do better next time for our next lecture coming up in October. I want to thank you all so much for joining us today and listening to this amazing lecture, and thank you to Joanne and Kylie for an amazing talk tonight.